Hi everyone. In this last part of quantum mechanics, what I want to do is use the rules of quantum mechanics that we learn, all the different things that we talked about, and primarily the basically the energy function that we got from quantum mechanics of multi-electron systems, and use that to explain periodic properties of elements. Okay? And in this discussion, we're going to cover all of these different subtopics. And they all relate to the properties of elements in the periodic table. So we're going to talk about why elements in the same group are found to have similar properties. We're going to talk about why noble gases tend to be relatively inert, in other words, they don't react that much. Why elements, other elements tend to be reactive, and why they form ions of a specific charge, for example, a plus one versus a negative one ions. And we're going to talk specifically about these periodic properties. Why there's a trend in ionization energy, why there's a trend in electron affinity, atomic radii, metallic characteristics, and certain reactivity trends in group 1a and 7a elements. We're also going to talk lastly about the what we refer to as the isoelectronic series, which is basically ions that all have the same number of electrons. And we're going to use again, same concepts, the concept of this energy function to predict the radii of these ions, these isoelectronic ions. So one of the first things to talk about is just why is the periodic table arranged the way it was, or it is, I should say. And the first arrangement of the periodic table, organization of the periodic table, was basically the idea was that there's certain elements that have very similar properties to each other, and people can see that even at the time. And these are then grouped together in a column. And there are several people who contributed to this effort, but the main person who made the effort to just bring everything together, of course, is Dmitri Mendeleev. And we talked about him before in topic two in this class. And I'm just bringing him up again here because his contribution was so important in setting up the first periodic table, and from then on, people just kind of work off that periodic table and built on it. And so, some of the elements that were grouped in together in a column, of course, are group 1a elements. For example, lithium, sodium, and potassium. And the reason they were grouped together at the time was that everybody could see that they're all soft, malleable metals. They tend to have similar properties. Another grouping of elements is the noble gases. People found that helium, sodium, and neon and argon are all inert. They don't react with other elements. So then they figure these are very similar in reactivity, so they must belong in the same group. And that's really how the first periodic table got started. Now, the elements, after they were organized according to the groups, they were then ordered according to their masses, okay, how heavy they are. And once they were ordered according to their masses, then it appears that there's a repeating pattern in terms of the elements that belong in a group. So it seems like it always repeats after a certain number of elements. Okay, and of course, that's what we see in the modern periodic table. We see that after a certain number of elements, the same, the element that belong in a group is repeated again here, okay, in that same group. So then you notice that there's this pattern of repeating mass that comes back to the element in the same group again. So Mendeleev realized this, and he called this the periodic law of elements, okay, basically kind of a repeating pattern in the elements based on their mass. This periodic law is often also called periodicity, and another term for it is periodic trends. So, in other words, all of these different phrases really mean the same thing. They refer to the idea that elements seem to have a repeating sequence in terms of their properties. Now, even though Mendeleev was able to organize the elements based on their periodicity, he wasn't able to explain why the periodicity must exist. And really, it's not until quantum mechanics was developed and the electron configuration of elements were determined for all of these different elements in the periodic table that people were able to figure out and explain why there has to be periodicity in elements. And of course, that's what we're going to do in this segment of this topic. which is use quantum mechanics and explain why we see periodic trends. So the first thing you can quickly see that you can easily explain is just this idea why all of these elements, for example, in group 1A have to be grouped together, okay? And the easy thing to see there is the fact that if you were to write the electron configuration, let's say for the first three elements in group 1A, hydrogen, lithium, and sodium, you quickly notice that, and I made a circle here to note that those are the elements. Hydrogen electron configuration is 1s1, lithium electron configuration is 1s2, 2s1, and sodium's configuration is 1s2, 2s1, 2p6, and 3s1. Now, what do you notice about the similarity between these three elements? Very quickly, you notice that they all have one valence electrons, because remember that the valence shell is basically the outermost shell of any element, and the outermost shell in hydrogen is the 1s shell. For lithium is the 2s or 2 shell number 2, n equals 2, and then for sodium is n equals 3. In all these three cases, there's only one electron in that valence shell. And so if there's only one electron and that's the outermost shell, that means that the electron can react in a certain way. And because you only have one electron, all of these guys are going to react in a certain way. Not only do they all have the same number of electrons, but if you look here, the other thing that is similar about them, of course, is that all these electrons are located in the s orbital. So they have the same number of electrons, and they also have the same type of orbital. And that makes it very likely that they're going to react in a very similar manner. And that's why we found that they belong in the same group. But remember that the grouping was done first before the explanation come about. So it's sort of like backwards in this case. People figure this that these guys should belong in the same group, and then later on quantum mechanics help us understand why they belong in the same group. You can do this for potassium as well. Potassium, in fact, is the next element after argon, and you notice that it's basically all of this and 4s1. And so you notice that another one electron in an s orbital is potassium, and so that makes sense in terms of the ordering right here. Okay. The second thing we can talk about is why noble gases are inert and why elements tend to form certain ions, certain charge. So if you look at a noble gas configuration, okay, something like helium, for example, which is 1s2, and then you look at another noble gas, which is neon, and neon is right here, 1s2, 2s2, 2p6, and then you look at third noble gas, which is argon, 1s2, 2s2, 2p6, 3s2, and 3p6. What do you notice about these configuration? What you notice, I hope you notice, is you see that they max out, they fill all the orbitals in that particular shell. So in the first shell, there's only one orbital, which is the 1s orbital, and the maximum number of electrons you can have there is 2, and helium fills out that orbital. In the second shell, for neon, there's two orbitals that are possible, the 2s and the 2p orbitals, and of course the 2s can accommodate 2 electrons, the 2p can accommodate 6 electrons. And when you look at the electron configuration of neon, it fills out all of those orbitals, both the core and the valence orbitals. And for argon, it's the same. You have 1s, 2s, and 3s, and 3p, and they all fill that out. Now, you might make an argument, and you'd be justified if you say this, that there's also a 3d orbital that is not listed here. And you're right, there is that, and that's actually going to be a something we would discuss later on when we talk about covalent bonding. But at this point, you can consider that argon basically fills out all the space that's available in the third shell in n equals 3. And why is that important? Well, it's important because if you fill out all your orbitals in that particular shell with electrons, that means that you really have no additional desire to get more electrons. Because if you add another electron, what has to happen with this something like neon, for example, is that in order for you to add that extra electron, it now has to go to the third level, right? The 3s level. And that would require energy in order to add that electron in, because that orbital, the 3s orbital, is a lot higher in energy. So that means you have to put in energy in order to make that happen. And processes on our universe just don't happen that way. They don't, systems try to lower their energy, they don't try to go to higher energy. Okay? It's the way things work in our universe is always that they try to go to a lower energy, more stable state from an energetic point of view. So as a result, there's no desire for these noble gases, which already have all their orbitals filled, to add more electrons or even to lose their electrons. They don't have any desire to do that by making a bond. In other words, by reacting, because those steps are energetically costly. It costs them energy in order to make that happen. So as a result, they don't react, and if they don't react, then that's what we call inert, right? Now, I would mention this though, and we'll talk about this more when we talk about the Lewis structure and noble and the compounds that are formed with noble gases, that larger noble gases do react, and there is a reason for that. And the reason has to do with that 3D orbital that I mentioned earlier. And as you go higher, you'll notice that there are other additional orbitals that are not filled, even though they belong in that shell. And that really is the reason why some of those noble gases can react, the larger ones, because there are orbitals and they're empty. And those orbitals belong in the same shell. So, in other words, for the larger noble gases, they haven't filled out the entire shell yet. And so there's space for them to add electrons. Okay? I'm going to continue with this a little bit on the same line to explain why other elements who do not have noble gas electron configuration actually tend to react in a certain way. And you understand the reasoning that we just mentioned about noble gases is that they're extremely stable, right? There's no reason for them to either get electrons or lose electrons because they fill out all their orbitals already in that shell, and that gives them a very stable state. Other elements, on the other hand, they don't have that, right? So if you look at something like sodium, for example, sodium is 1s2, 2s2, 2p6, 3s1, okay? So this part of it is a noble gas, 1s2, 2s2, 2p6. In fact, that's neon. But then the 3s1 is not. Okay? So sodium, as a result, is not as stable as neon. So if sodium wants to stabilize itself, the easiest thing for it to do would be to lose that one electron and become something that looks like neon. When it loses that one electron, then it becomes a cation, sodium plus, right? Na plus. You look at something like chlorine, 1s2, 2s2, 2p6, 3s2, 3p5. It basically has a choice. Again, it's not a noble gas yet, and noble gases are stable, so it wants to stabilize itself. It could either gain another electron to make itself look like argon, or it could lose 7 electrons to make itself look like neon. Well, losing 7 electrons is a lot more difficult than gaining 1 electron, and as a result, chlorine would gain 1 electron. That make it look like a an argon atom, and as a result, we see chloride ion. Okay, and that's the explanation here at the bottom. Okay, some elements would lose electrons, forming cations, and they only lose a certain number of electrons. So, for example, sodium, you don't see sodium 2 plus, you always only see sodium plus, and the reason is because there's no need to lose 2 electrons. The 1 electron is what it needs to lose to make itself look like a noble gas. Same thing with gaining electrons. The anions, you don't see Cl2 minus, you just see Cl minus, and the reason is, again, same thing, because it only needs to gain 1 electron to make itself look like argon. However, you have something like magnesium, which is 1s2, 2s2, 2p6, 3s2. Now it makes sense for it to lose 2 electrons, because in order for it to become a noble gas, it has to lose that 2 electrons. Okay, it can't just lose 1 electron. So you don't see Mg plus, but you see Mg2 plus.